There is another very interesting facet of this development. When a person develops intuitive ability, now I am using this phrase, there is a contradiction in this phrase. I said when you develop the intuitive ability. Why am I saying this? Because it's a statement we were trained to use our minds very readily accept. But if I were to say you can't develop intuition, you can develop other skills, you can develop how to think. You can develop how to remember, memorize, learn, how to repeat a thing over and over again, how to repeat with skill. But you cannot learn how to use intuition. When I say that, then people say, then what can we do? They feel helpless. So I give a little concession to the mind in making these statements to you, that if we can develop our intuition, which means the same thing, if we start observing and listening to our intuition a little more, we would find all these changes taking place in us. You will have this opportunity every day. If you listen to intuition and take that as your guidance or as your guide, you want to make a decision and an intuition comes, never ignore it. Not that you start choosing, evaluating intuition, then you go back to the mind game. When you get an intuitive hunch, the gut knowledge tells you, do this, then do it. What about the thoughts? The thoughts say, how can you be sure? What is the reason? We planned out something else. This is not what we planned. This is not what I planned. If the thoughts go on saying these things, use them to implement, work out what the intuition just said. Work out the system. Try it in your day-to-day life. To make decisions, major decisions in life, if intuition tells you something, follow it. Then use the mind, all the mechanical intellectual process, how to do it, how to carry it out, not to go back upon it. If you do it this way, the mind feels very happy eventually to do its job and the intuition is guiding you what to do. Now when that happens, then the nature of coincidences starts changing. And coincidences start happening which correspond exactly with your intuition. That makes you feel this is a strange, uncanny business going on. This is not a simple method of one thought coming into my head, that my consciousness has a control over circumstances. If you have intuition and listen to it, you will have coincidences following that intuition, corroborating that intuitive feeling. Now coincidence is an outside circumstantial happening. It is happening outside in your life. Intuition is a subjective feeling inside you. But when you see the two go together, you get a great sense of satisfaction, joy, and certainty. And your life becomes fearless. Because the ignorance that caused fear, the hesitancy that caused fear, the doubt that caused fear disappears. Therefore, it is not a subjective suggestion I am making to you. I am not saying, here's a good suggestion, positive thinking, positive suggestion. Think that your gut knowledge is good. Think you have all the stuff in your head. And now go ahead. I am not saying that at all. I am saying, if you are willing to listen to your intuition whenever it comes and act upon it, you will see a correlation between that intuition and the circumstances of life, which will give you a feeling that they go together. And since the mind tends to think that you have no control over these outside circumstances, except where you can use your ego, therefore the mind is put in its own place when you see that happening, and greater reliance comes on the reality of a creator, a reality of a power that runs the universe inside and outside. And that reality is linked to your own consciousness so strongly as if your own consciousness in its own fullness is that reality. You get that feeling. So it is a great experience to relate outside life with the inner things happening, to see how protective it can be. Supposing you are afraid of accidents. Let me take some concrete examples. Somebody always trips over, falls, gets hurt, and is afraid of accidents. After that, after this lecture this evening, you go and have reliance upon your intuition and act upon it. And then, coincidentally, you will find you will be avoiding the accidents. I am not, this is empirical statement I am making. I am not saying that, what is the link? There is no cause and effect link. That is why it is not mental. But it is a fact. You have to see that consciousness is operating in a way other than we know. If for some of you who would like to know how it happens, I can give you a little inkling for mental rumination, for thinking about it, how it happens. It happens that what we are seeing outside, what looks like a fixed status universe in which we are operating, is in fact not so. What we are seeing outside of ourselves is a very thin slice of experience put in place exactly according to what our consciousness can perceive. Which means that the world outside is not being perceived by us because we have senses, but we are creating a world outside of ourselves according to what we are capable of inside. The mind is not ready to accept these things, but I still want to tell you to think over it. I can give you an example. When you go to sleep at night and have a dream, and in the dream you walk about and meet people, that dream looks absolutely real. It looks like that world has always been there. Supposing you go to sleep late one night at 12 o'clock, midnight, and after a while, the first dream sequence starts in 7 minutes, and you see a strange Egyptian city, old one, with a building 1400 years old, and a blue sky having a very strange blue color on top, which has been there forever, and a guide is standing there near the building showing you and explaining, this building is so old, look at the moss on this. And you look at it and you say, this is really old. And you have suddenly had an experience of history of a human being, your own history, for 1400 years, and a huge infinite sky. And 7 minutes later, somebody disturbs you and you wake up. After 14 minutes, you say, what happened? After 14 minutes after midnight, you have been through an experience of 1400 years. Until you woke up, that was real. Till you woke up, nothing could convince you that that building has not been there, that 1400 years were not there, that the infinite sky is not there. Where did all that come from? Where did that infinite time and infinite space come? It was not there 7 minutes earlier and it wasn't there 7 minutes later. How could infinity be created in a short span of 7 minutes? And it looked real. And while we are in the sleep state, if somebody else came in and said, what are you wasting your time on this building? It doesn't exist. We are dreaming. You say, you may be dreaming. I am really looking at it. I can touch it. Here it is. It's real. You don't believe it? I'll ask the guide. Guide, is it real? He says, real. He says, no, but guide is also a dream. Okay, let's call some more people. You call 200 people from inside the building. Are you all guys seeing this building? Yeah, we are all seeing. So it's real. Isn't that the same verification we apply to this life? There is no difference whatsoever in terms of the operation of consciousness. In terms of our knowledge of the reality of what we are experiencing, we have no better proof or evidence that this physical universe we are now watching has a greater degree of reality than the dream sequence that we saw. The only thing is, we could not be convinced that it was a dream till we woke up. And once we woke up, nobody can convince us that was real. And nobody ever says, I want to go to dream world to investigate what I missed out on that building. Because the knowledge that it came out from consciousness within. When we wake up in the morning, we know where the dream was inside our head. We know the 1400 years were inside our head. The building was inside our head. Inside our head where? Not in the cranium, not in the bones, not in the brain, but in the consciousness that created the dream. While the dream lasts, it looks like it's real outside. When we wake up, and terminate it, we find out it came from inside. Believe me, this universe we are seeing now, which looks so real, is real because of our consciousness and is being projected out the same way. If we could wake up to a higher level of consciousness, just like we wake up from a dream, if we could wake up to a super physical level, we would know this was created by us through consciousness anyway. Therefore, the circumstances and coincidences which we marvel at are nothing to be marveled at. They are natural to correlate with the consciousness inside because they are the product of the same consciousness. Now, who can tell us? Only somebody who's experienced the wakeful state and is still retaining that in order to talk to us while we are dreaming. If we want to have proof, give us proof that what we are now seeing is not really outside, but we are creating it through our consciousness. Give us some real proof. And the real proof is wake up and see it for yourself. But then how do we wake up? Supposing at night somebody tries to wake us up while we are having a nice dream. Now, I give this example so often, and I can give it today because of Stan's birthday party. Supposing I'm having a dream, and the dream I'm having a lovely pizza I brought from Friendly Pizza. So good. I like it. But I'm in my dream looking at it, tasting it so good. And Stan is awake. He knows the party is over. There's no pizza left. This guy just in his dream having feeling. So he wants to wake me up and he nudges me in the side. Just get up, wake up. When he nudges me in the side, what happens? He is nudging me in the side of the body that is sleeping. I am not conscious that I am sleeping. I am dreaming that I am sitting up. This is the way he is trying to wake me up. He is trying to pull me from the threshold of the dream into the wakeful physical state. When he tries to do that and nudges me, I am still conscious of my pizza. And I say, Stan, don't nudge me. I have to finish my pizza. And he says, oh, don't worry. I'll hold your pizza while you wake up. I say, okay, here it is. So I give him the pizza so that he can wake me up. And then I wake up and find there was no pizza at all. That I wasn't even sitting up. That I was sleeping in bed. That he was nudging me from the side. That he did say, I will hold your pizza. But the object, why he said that, was to wake me up and not to hold the pizza. What would happen in a real life situation? Supposing we are sitting in this situation and there is a person amongst us. Or there is a person awakened, not amongst us. And that person who is awakened, we are not even dreaming of that person. And he wants to waken us up into our real self and start nudging us there. That experience will transmit itself into this life. And we will feel a coincidence is happening, strange things are happening, we should seek something inside, we should do something to waken up. And we'll say, no, but I have to do my work here, what about my job, what about my family, what about my house, I have to take care of all these, let me write out the checks and pay the bills, I don't know if I'll come back here. We say all these things because we are taking it as real, haven't woken up. But when we wake up, we find that the person who appeared in our dream and participated, willing to help us in the disposal of our things in this dream, was actually not doing that. Actually, his object was to waken us up. And his participation in our life was merely to waken us up. What would we call that person? Shall we call him the wakened one, the enlightened one, a master, a guru, whatever you like. The Eastern tradition says guru is a good name for such a person. But only for such a person. Who is a real spiritual teacher? One who is already awake and can participate in our physical dreamlike state and waken us up to a higher level. What is the proof that we have such a state is to be awakened. There is no other proof. Do you wake up every morning, all of you? Please raise your hands if you wake up every morning. How many of you have called in for proof to show that you are awake? None. Supposing there are 20 people who come visiting you in the morning and they say, look, you aren't really awake, you're still sleeping. You won't believe it. The proof of waking up is built into itself. It doesn't require the corroboration by somebody else's testimony. Similarly, when we rise to a level of consciousness that is a higher wakeful state than the physical level we are accustomed to now, the transformation into that wakefulness is its own proof. And what one talks to us in this level to take us to that wakeful state is merely participation in this level, not for the purpose of perpetuating this level, but for taking us to a higher level. Once we are able to wake up and even retain some memory, we are willing to sleep again. Do you know that sleep is a lower form of consciousness than wakefulness? Would you rather do your work in sleep or while you are awake? You'd rather do it while awake. You regard wakefulness as a higher state. Yet you go to sleep every night. You don't mind the risk because you know you will wake up again. In the same way, even if you have higher level of consciousness available to you, it is no risk to go back to the physical level. That is why these mystics, having experienced that and retained that experience, can personally instruct us how we can have an experience of higher wakefulness and return for some rest into the physical self whenever we like. This is a strange combination of levels of consciousness that gives us the fullness of human consciousness. Consciousness is not that limited that we think. Consciousness is not a function of the human body. Consciousness is the creator of the human body. Consciousness is not merely how we know there is a world around it. Consciousness is the creator of the world around it. Consciousness is not something through which we can have a peep into heaven. Consciousness is the creator of those heavens. Consciousness is not something through which we can understand and reach out to God. Consciousness is that understanding and is that God. Consciousness is not something in which love is poured in. Consciousness is the substance that love is made. All these things we can find by going within, by experiencing love. When you can experience love, you will find the veracity of what I have told you today. And when you have found the veracity of these things, you will become fearless. One thing that goes away from a spiritual person's life is fear. One thing that comes back is the certainty, knowledge, knowing how it's happening, why it's happening. When you know how it's happening, why this world, why are we here, what role are we performing, what is this grand show, who set it up, who is the director, what is our role as an actor, what should we do next? When you know all these questions, you will have no fear. And you will then say, now you understood that fear came only from ignorance, and this knowledge takes away all fear. Thank you very much. Thank you. I shall be very happy, as usual, to answer a few questions if you have on the presentation I have made or on the presentation I have not made. Yes? Yes. It's a good question because just like attachments are frequently mistaken to be love, quick mental calculation is frequently considered to be intuition. Intuition is distinguished from a mental exercise by the fact it has no time involved. When the intuitive hunch comes, you cannot give it any time at all. You cannot say it took 1 second to come. You cannot say it took 1/10 of a second, or 1 millionth of a second, or 1 billionth of a second. It was not there and suddenly it is there. Nor is it connected with your thought process. Supposing a person says, I have started to live by intuition, I heard a lecture last night, and from today I'm going to live by intuition. Now I want to decide something. Should I go in my red car or green car today? I want intuition to tell me. Right, red. That is not intuition. That's a mental game. Because the time taken to plan this and to organize it, even though sometimes decisions come to us by skipping certain stages of logic, they still take time and are not pure intuition. Pure intuition is that which comes spontaneously without time. So the main distinction is that one knows within cause-effect relationship. If you expect intuition, it doesn't come. Have you ever seen that those who have a lot of intuitive hunches, that if you sit down one day, today I'm going to wait for intuition to come, that day it will not come. Because you already set your mind to operate in a certain way. So even if intuition is flowing, it will just flow by bypass, into the bypass. Therefore, if you are thinking of this thing, and suddenly some other knowledge comes up not connected with what you are thinking, that's more likely to be intuition. But the real test is, there should be no element of time in the experience. Yes. No, I am a very uneducated person actually. After studying economics and politics here, I just gave up. There is a friend of mine living in Boston area. After many years, he called me one day. I was on a visit to this country. And he said, I am getting more and more confused. I have read every possible book on the subject. And he used to acquire all the books, even when I was here in Cambridge. He used to acquire every book on the subject. Then he got so many books, huge stack of library. And he said, the more I am read, the more I am getting confused. These terms mean something else. And tell me, what should I do? I said, take all these books that you have and throw them into the river, Charles. As the first step. Then call me back. Now, I'm not against books, by the way, I must tell you. All I'm saying is one can get overlearned and start treating certain words which are used in literature in a certain context and start collating them, interpolating them and trying to see what to make out of it. So, I have very often said that let us not get trapped. So, since I say to others, naturally, I don't read too much myself, so I am sorry that I am not familiar, but you can make me familiar with it now on the essence of what you want to say. Just a coincidence. I'll tell you, when I was a student here, I spoke in Detroit once, and I spoke on exact mathematics and exact logic, that these are not logical things what we are doing. I said that what we call logical is totally illogical. And I gave a lot of examples how what we think is logical is being treated by us logical because of the error of the connotation of words we are employing in that logical sequence. The syllogism is not logical at all. And I talked of exact logic. And a person who was sitting with a professor, he said to me afterwards, are you familiar with the works of Charles Peirce Sanders, because he has written the same things. You read those? I said, I haven't read them. Then you might as well do it. He sent me 10 volumes, such a huge library of his works in original. When I opened them, I was surprised. He was saying that by the time I came to this country to speak on the subject, he was dead already. So, I don't know. These coincidences do happen in life. But one thing I want to share with you. That whatever you do, whatever the source of your knowledge, whatever the source of your experience, if you go within on the basis of that source, you will come across the same experience that others have had. And that is a great, great veracity of the fact that truth is one. When we analyze truth, we make it look different. People who experience truth experience the same thing. But people who analyze and talk about truth, they say different things. That is how all the religions came up. All the denominations came up. All different church groups came up. One person comes, walks upon this earth from personal enlightenment and personal realization. He speaks the truth. And all the others start saying, no, that's what he said. The other said, no, that's not what he said. We know better what he said. They all try to grab the same person and set up a new religion, set up a new denomination. Keep on dividing. Keep on editing what he said. When there's a new nation, you know, United States is a new nation. By the time you got your first Bible into this country, it had already been edited 14 times. You know that. You only got the 14th authorized version. Authorized by the king, not by the pope. So you see, these are the things that we do to scriptures and to the messages of the masters. And they give us such simple message. What is the message of Jesus Christ? When I look at it, it is the same message the great master gave me. It's the same message I've always heard. The message was so beautiful. It said, the truth is within you. Go within and find the truth and you will find it is love. Isn't that the message? It's the basic message. What have people done after listening to the message? They went everywhere, every library, every church, every denomination, every place except within themselves. And they tried every kind of argument, even hitting people, killing people instead of love. And they still thought they were following the one who gave that message. So this is how our mind, just like she was saying that we are constantly bombarded by intuition, but the mind doesn't let us come through. Similarly, truth is part of ourselves. Truth and love is part of ourselves. We don't learn how to love. We don't learn love. We are made of that substance. Consciousness is made of the substance. When you remove the functioning of the human mind, the thoughts, the doubts and all these, put them aside, love, beauty, joy, intuition will flow automatically inside without learning. They are not learned. They are already there. So the truth is all within. Yes. That's a very beautiful question. There is in Hong Kong a garden called the Tiger Balm Garden. Anybody has been to Hong Kong or Singapore from here? Have you seen that? Hopa Garden, the maker of Tiger Balm, he set up those gardens in these two cities. And there are some nice statues and he made it for entertainment of people to see. In one corner of the Tiger Balm Garden, there are 5 statues of the Buddha, representing the 5 wisdoms of the Buddha. They represent the 5 wisdoms that we require in order to reach our own higher self. And what are those 5 wisdoms? The first is hope. It is said that if you have no hope, which has been interpreted as the same as the biblical word seek, you will never seek if you have no hope. The seeking or the hoping is essential as the first wisdom to move on the spiritual path. The second one is learn. Learning is the second wisdom. If you hope but don't want to learn, hope remains where it is. The third one is reasoning, because they felt that if what you accept has a doubt lurking in your reasoning mind, you will not make progress. The doubt will come back again and again. Great master who taught me said, never try and tell a person, oh, this is a subject beyond your questions. Don't ask any questions. Because if you do that and you suppress the questions, then the questions will creep up at the time when they're trying to make progress. And the mind can play a game with a person. Okay, you want to make spiritual growth. What about this question of mine? You are just being led blindly. You may be led by the devil. Who knows where you are going? All kinds of spanners can be thrown into your spiritual progress if you don't have the reasoning questions answered in the process of your growth. So third wisdom is the reasoning. The fourth wisdom is attainment. Whatever you want to reach, you apply reasoning. Take step by step that learning and hope and get the attainment. And the fifth, which is supposed to be the best part of Buddhist wisdom, is accepting. Whatever you got, that's it. This is life. This is what there is. What's happening is happening. Remember, what is the reality. What ought to be is a mental fantasy. But we are living far more on what ought to be than what is. And so you go progressively to discover what is, and hope is the first part. So far as faith is considered different in our terminology from belief. A belief can be created by our respect for a person who makes a statement. I have a lot of respect for a friend of mine, and he, whatever statement he makes, I normally accept. He says, give up ye old Shakey's pizza, turn over to Pizza Hut. And I go, because I have I believe his statements are right. But then I come to New England and they say, no, you must go to friendlies. So I go to friendlies. I believe certain people. If such a person were to come and say to me, you know, God is a reality. He is a being. And right now sitting upstairs. I could believe that. But this belief can put me into a religion, into a cult, can put me into a group, and I can start creating my own group, repeating the belief. With nothing to grow on, even after 5 years, I will say, I believe what I heard that just because that person said so. But faith is considered different from belief because faith can grow. Faith grows from experience. If a certain experience takes place, I have faith this can happen. If a second experience takes place, then more faith comes up. Faith grows by the growth of experience. What does faith do in the meanwhile? Faith takes the place of experience, the substitute for experience. Supposing we need experience for more faith, some faith can lead us to more faith. Supposing we need faith and we get experience, it leads to more faith. So faith and experience become interchangeable. Therefore, they constantly grow. And this living faith is something that grows all the time. And so faith has a very big part to play. Hope is necessary to give the first shot, to push you into this. And faith gives you the opportunity where some steps are missing or very high, you can substitute them by faith and move on. They both play important role. Yes? Oh yes, it's good to remember. But you can remember the experience of love as much as you can remember the experience of intuition and enjoy both. I will tell you about memory, that what we call memory. If somebody says, what's your name? And I say, my name is Ishwar. I've used my memory just now. I've not relived any experience at all. I just accessed a very easy spot which was constantly being bombarded by my name, constantly being reinforced, and I had no problem. You asked, what's your name? I said, Ishwar. I accessed that memory and said, there was no experience involved. But I can have an experience of remembering how I was named, how somebody called me in this way. I can pick up certain special experiences related to my name. And then that becomes a deeper memory. By imagination, I can replay those. When we recall physically a particular memory, it is a mechanical process. It does not give us any spiritual satisfaction. When we recall through sensory association, then it becomes an astral experience. As an astral experience, it goes deep into our senses. And if you had some experience of senses associated with that, that experience comes back again. Because it is not the physical body that is remembering. It is the mind that is remembering using the astral process, which is the sensory process. But supposing you remember using the mind itself, then you relive the whole process. Which in other words means that what you think that is what you are doing now in the real life could itself be a relived memory. It's not only that you enjoy something that you remember remaining intact with this condition that you are in. You can remember from the causal level, in which case you relive it, wiping out what you were doing earlier. That is how many of us are here. Many of us are here to remember and relive what happened earlier. Where do we pick up these memories from? From the causal Akashic records, where all these events are programmed earlier in advance. So those memories can create a new life pattern which we are leading. How can one know that these are things, this is how they happen, going within? How do we stimulate these? The more you go within your own self, the deeper you evoke the memories. The more external and superficial you are, the less those memories come from within. It is still different from thought. It is this recollection and reliving of memory, it is not the same thing as thought. Because you can think of a thing and not remember anything. Or you can remember without having to think of it. Have you ever got a memory without thinking about it? And you have thought hard for it and you can't remember it? This happened the other day with my friend Clarence Brinson. He was going to introduce me to a talk last week, I think, in Rochester, Minnesota. And the title of the talk was a very interesting one, a new type, Glimpses of, what was that, Clarence? Now you remember? And the hostess there, Nancy Powers, she said, Clarence, I can give you this flyer. At least you will know when you introduce him what the title of the talk is today. He said, no, I remember that. I said, but he's likely to, I predicted that he'll forget it by the time he reaches there. He said, no, such a simple statement, glimpses of human development or something. And by the time he came, she still gave him that flyer. And he came and put the flyer in his pocket. And he was going to announce, now you know, Ishwar Puri is going to talk on. And he fumbled. And he forgot. And he tried. And he forgot and he wanted to know how it happened. And he had to pull out the paper and read it from there. Sometimes you can try and think as hard as you like and not relive the memory. Sometimes you can suddenly relive the whole thing without even thinking about it. So what accesses the memory is the movement of attention to your own self within and not thinking. Thinking does not create. What happens is thinking can induce a dream state. Thinking can link logical sequences. Thinking has its own function. It has got very good functions. I am not telling you don't think, because even if I told you, you can't stop. What I am saying is make good use of it. Don't put the cart before the horse. That's what I am saying. The correct way to lead a good, happy, fearless life is to use intuition and soul for making your decisions in life and using your mind to carry out how to do it. But what are people doing? They are using their mind to decide what to do and fumbling upon it and having taken a decision which turns out in 50% cases to be wrong, then they rely upon intuition somehow to set it right. It's the opposite. So put the cart, don't put the cart before the horse. Yes.
Something happened in my life 10 days ago with someone I knew committed suicide. And I couldn't come up with the answer to a certain question. If everything is predestined and we take out our video cassettes before we enter this life and plug it in, is that suicide also part of God's will? Or is that a method?
Who is God? You tell me that and I'll tell you whose will it is. Exactly. Therefore, when we say God's will, we can be merely using this expression, God, to separate something from ourselves in order to push on responsibility. If God is our own totality, who are we blaming? If God is our own highest self, who laid down the records? If our own fullness is God, we are responsible for everything, including the pattern of life that we created for ourselves. Therefore, the answer to that question would depend upon what predicates we have set for these definitions of God, ourselves, the role that we are playing, how many are there in the physical level of creation, in the level in which we are conducting this lecture and dialogue. The feeling and experience that we are separated by physical bodies is real. We can't avoid it. When we talk of suicide, we talk of a person who extinguishes life in a physical body. What happened to that consciousness? Did it go back? Is it still hanging there? Can we go and test it out? These are the questions that are relevant at this stage. What God did, we can only raise at that level. What has happened to the disembodied spirit, we can only see when we are in the disembodied astral region. You have to be at that level to be able to link the relationship of different events that are happening now. For example, there are people who, when they are born, they remember their past lives. They remember their past life in the physical body. They don't remember what happened in between. I have met a lot of them. And I tell them, look, you remember what you were so long ago, and then you died. And then you were born. What happened in between? They can't link it up. Why? What is the handicap? The handicap is the memory is coming back to them in the physical body, and only that can be accessed which was in the physical body earlier. What happened to the other life? There are people who can now, by yogic practice, by going within, separate their consciousness from the physical body, temporarily withhold the awareness of the physical body, find out that they are still conscious and can move around, and look at their own body in which they are moving around, and find out it is 1,000 years old. And then how does this relate with the physical body? It's only 40, 50 years old. And they look back and say, this physical body is 40 years old. I have suppressed that experience deliberately through this meditative process, through the process of concentration of attention on myself. I have become oblivious of the physical body, and I have become conscious of who I am. And what I now have, I can remember what happened 500 years ago. I can remember my own things. All those memories come back. What was happening in between? And they find in between, they were also physical bodies. But the memory of the whole non-physical self comes back. And one discovers one is born and dies even in that form. But after 1,000, 2,000 years. Supposing one can suppress the information and the memory of that body and go to the causal level, one finds one has been here for 1,000,000 years. One can see the whole of creation where it came up and see it. See it in terms of personally remembering it. Not in terms of written somewhere. Personally, like you personally remember what you ate today, where you came from, what happened yesterday, what happened 10 days ago. Like your own personal memory, the same memory comes back to you because you are not in that physical form. So, you get different answers at different stages. When you go to the astral form, you find that people who committed suicide are still there. When you give responsibility, the ultimate responsibility becomes the responsibility of the self in its final form. It should not be made into an academic exercise in the sense of distributing responsibility as between two, God and somebody else. Because when you come to the level where God can be realized, there is only one. When you come to the level where we are separated, we don't have knowledge of God. So, this is a transformation in our level of consciousness. When we do get to the level of consciousness of God, we find there is only one. And the rest is illusion. Including suicide, including karma, including free will. As a grand illusion set up, you have the experience of this whole drama. Why do we have such sad parts built into this? You know that. You get create the pairs of opposites. We are in the world of pairs of opposites. In fact, this experience is being sustained by the pairs of opposites. If you don't have darkness, you don't see light. If you don't have light, you don't know what is darkness. If you have no unhappiness, supposing there is no unhappiness in this world, people would never know what is happening. You just will have no feeling. Supposing a person joy is different. Bliss, joy that we talk of is different. But how is that sustained, that joy, bliss, by the opposite of this? There is no opposite. So we create an illusion of an opposite. To make it appear now in the illusion. To make it appear in the illusion that there is an opposite. So the whole thing is placed in it. Perfectly. I don't know, some people may be sharper than I am. I have spent a lot of time, half a century after initiation. I am just celebrated my 60th birthday, running 61st birthday, spent a lot of years in this, and all I could come to after seeing this creation, after seeing whatever God has created, is a degree of perfection in the totality of creation that I cannot improve. honestly, I am honestly telling you, if you take a total view of creation, at every level of consciousness, it is very, I can't find anybody who can give a suggestion to God. God, if you did this, it will improve. So perfect. Things are placed very perfectly. Yes. Okay, we should record the... Oh, now, that's a good question, actually. Because this came up in one of my discussions about smaller. What is small and what is big? What is small? A philosopher once made a circle. He says, without touching it, can you make it small? He said, how can you do it without touching it? Another guy said, I can do it. How? He came and put another bigger one next to it. It becomes small. Small and big are relative to each other. There is a theory of the creation of this universe, a physical theory, which says that we are formed of matter and molecular matter. We are formed of this because of a Big Bang. You heard of the Big Bang theory? Still quite an acceptable theory, though more alternatives are coming up as we get more educated and think more about it. But the Big Bang theory says that we are all expanding. We're all becoming bigger than we are all the time. We have not yet been able to determine at what rate we are becoming bigger. I believe Peggy is going to show us, take us to some show where they might give an astronomical answer at what rate we are expanding. There are different theories on that. But the rate, but whatever is accepted today is that while I gave my lecture, you, all of you grew many times your size. Did you know that? While I was lecturing to you, you all bloated up and grew many times your size and never even noticed. Why didn't you notice? Because the room also grew. The table grew. I grew. Everything grew at the same rate. Since everything became bigger, we did not notice it became bigger. Therefore, what is big and small is totally relative to each other. And there are small particles moving, small cells moving, which have a genetic code. Now we have good knowledge. We can use very technologically advanced equipment to find out what is happening to small particles. In the nucleus of the genetic code of every cell, of every living thing on this universe is a map of the entire universe. And that cell can determine at the right time which direction to take. And the wisdom of the cell to tell it when to grow according to that map and when to stop is built into it. So it is so small that we have got billions of them in our body. And each one of the billions has all this map. What is small about it? Now, supposing we were reborn smaller than that cell and walked upon it, we could see the whole map. There's a big cell. Who told us it is small? So, it is the size of the observer that can change the size of the thing we are observing. It is said that when I used to go to school, they said, this world doesn't have much matter. Looks, because it's bloated up. It has all space. Because what is matter consists of molecules which are consisting of atoms, and the atoms are little bits of mass of the proton, and the rest of it are electrons revolving at great distances relative to the size of the proton, of the center. And the distance is as large in relation to the size as the distance of the planets from the sun. It's the same ratio. If it was not the same ratio, they would fall upon the center and collapse. The fact that they are still moving around, the electrons are still moving around the center nucleus of each atom, is possible because they are so far away, they can't fall upon it. Those that were too far away escaped and went away. Those that were too close fell upon it and became the center, the neutrons. Only those that were hung in the middle are still hanging loose, as the Hawaiians say. Those electrons are still hanging loose and they are constituting the matter as we know it. That is so. One physics professor told me in my class when I was studying for BSc in physics, he said, supposing the space between the electron and the proton was taken out, and they were allowed to collapse and the world could still exist, this Earth would become like the size of a football. 10 years later, a more qualified professor told me he was wrong. It would be of the size of a marble. When I came to Harvard and met the professors here in Boston, they said they were both wrong. It will be the top of a pinhead. Today, they are even questioning it will be that large. What will fill so much space? It depends on the pin. The point I'm making is that we are living in thin air and space. What are we living in? Thin space. That nothingness bloats us, making us into such big universe of this kind that we are seeing. Now, is this space or is nothingness? That leads to the very big question of what is space or what is nothingness, which philosophers, scientists, saints, mystics have tried to answer in different ways. What is nothingness? This is nothingness, is not emptiness. Nothingness must fill something and have properties. Just like space must be filled with something. We don't know what it is. Let's call it ether. It was an assumption. When they said call it ether, they had to assume because of the transmittal of waves through this emptiness. It can't transmit itself. Therefore, they assumed something must be filling it. And Einstein, of course, came up with the most fantastic ideas about size and things. He said, as many of you know here, if you have studied Einsteinian physics, he said, space is a function of matter. Supposing there are two bodies of matter put into space, they create a certain amount of space by the curvature in the space that they create. If you put a third body, it creates more space. You have as much space as the bodies you create. If you took away all the bodies, the whole space would collapse and there would be no space. Then he said, if you keep on putting more matter into the so-called emptiness that we call space, the space begins to get curved. If you keep on putting more stars, more planets, more galaxies, more nebula into the space, it can be so overpacked that the space may get curved to the extent of being a closed circuit. And he predicted that our universe has already reached that point. Some of you might know, he predicted that the curvature of space, just by the existence of too many heavenly bodies, has reached a point where space has curved itself to become a totality. So if you shoot out in a straight line here, you will end up exactly where you are. Not because of the Earth is round, but even in space, if you shoot out straight and remain straight, you will come where you are because of what he called the curvature in space. This thought that totally changed our whole concept of what space is, totally changed our concept of matter. So, in such a kind of space moving around, supposing there is a huge being living here, and these represent, the Earth and the planets represent merely some of the electrons and protons of one molecule, of one cell of that being, and we are moving around here, the being won't know us. Do we know what's happening on the cells in our body? We have no idea. Supposing each cell is containing a universe, no idea. Every time the scientific progress reports the smaller particles, they go down and say there are particles that can move right through X-rays, gamma rays, neurons. Now, neurons can move through any matter that we know of. Anything that we know of, neurons can pass right through as if there is no wall. You don't see anything. So, supposing we became neuron size and traveled around, we'll see what happened to all the creation. And we were just traveling in the same room here. We may travel in this room and find all emptiness. Where are all those people gone? There was a lecture going on. What happened to that? There's so many people here. The neurons will be trying, but the space between each one of our cells will be so much, it'll look like emptiness. It's a strange world we are living in. And the strangeness gives rise to all these questions we have. And scientists are trying to find answers, and mystics are providing the answers, and they are both now hitting out so close to each other. We wonder if they'll become the same. But one wise guy said they will never become the same. Because the joy of explaining is called the scientific approach. The joy of the mystery behind it is called the spiritual approach. These two can never overlap, even if you find the same stuff. The joy of the mystery is the spiritual stuff. And the joy of explaining is the scientific stuff. Their approach is different, not what we find. So don't worry about small size. Size is changing all the time, even of avocados. Yes? You wanted to say something, Huey? Yes.
I've heard people often say, my intuition, my immediate intuition is that person is no good. I looked at him, and right away I saw he was no good. Okay. This is reported as intuition. How do we respond to this?
It may be because of our lack of knowledge of why we react to people in a certain way. Because what you have raised is a question of our seeing somebody and suddenly liking that person or suddenly not liking that person. The mystics say that we have been here several times before, that we are coming again and again in different roles upon the same stage, and although our bodies are different, the physical bodies are different, the mental selves which the bodies are carrying inside are still the same that were there in our previous forms. And therefore, when we come, we carry all the memories and the attitudes that we had then. The attitudes and memories are being created by all the previous experiences. So when we meet somebody, and that recognition takes place not at the physical level, but at the level of the memory, we react in a certain way. This is explained as previous karma. This is because of previous karma that you are merely responding to what should happen by the memory of the past event at this time, and therefore not true intuition. Therefore, they explain it as the normal application of the law of karma. Okay.
Yes.
Yes. Consciousness is using many mechanisms. It is using the mechanism of individuation. I'm using broad terms, but within each there is a large number of experiences built in. When it uses the mechanism of individuation, we start calling that consciousness soul. Supposing it did not use that mechanism, we would call it God. It's the same consciousness. It is not two consciousnesses. It is not even 10, not a billion, just one. One consciousness is using a mechanism called individuation, and we call it soul and become so many. It's still one. Become so many by the mechanism. What creates the many is the mechanism and not the consciousness. But the consciousness experiences the mechanism of the many. Then it starts using the mechanism of the mind by creating a beginning, a middle, and an end in everything. The mind is nothing more. I had a good go at the mind today. No, I like to do it. But the truth is, there is no such thing as mind. It is merely a device, a mechanism that can put a timeless, eternal, single one experience into what looks like a beginning, middle, and end in a sequential linear experience. The sequential linear experience of putting a single knowledge, entity, being into this linear experience is called mind. Once that happens, it's only a mechanism. This mechanism creates a past, creates a future, creates a strange kind of timeless present, and gives us all the experiences, including karma, including free will, including morality, including choices. All this is a result of that single mechanism. You take that mechanism away, all this disappears.
We look places, even the physicists are beginning to realize that there's something called Schrödinger's cat, where you start to look. Your consciousness is already changing the effect because you're simply making the conscious effort to look. And once the consciousness moves to a place to look at something, it has already affected it.
That's Einstein warned about it before his death. He warned that people, scientists will have the biggest problem, which he says he could not give sufficient attention to, was the location of the subjective observer. That makes all the difference to the results. So the mechanism is affected by the user of the mechanism. If the subjective consciousness, as a point of view, observing a mechanism and its manifestation, itself shifts along with that, the whole experience changes. Totally. Then there's another interesting thing happening. When we come to the mechanism of creating a sequential order of experience, it goes down into the sensory perceptions, goes down to the physical, and we are operating under those conditions even now. As physical beings, the only thing is, we are restricted in our memory, so that we start thinking by identification with the bodies. We are born on a certain day, we have this name. All these are identification of the body. We start identifying the whole of ourselves with the description, and think we just came here for a short life in a huge big world. We forget about consciousness and we forget about the source from where we are having this experience. But then, once we are in this time flow, then we get into another mechanism called evolution. In evolution, we start evolving first in the physical form, constantly, so that it makes sense in the linear progress of time. Then we evolve in the mental imagery we are carrying, which is the law of karma, as I explained. Then we evolve in the consciousness and its rise to its own seeking, a spiritual evolution. All the spiral, all three spirals go on together, but not at the same speed. They are not connected, and yet they are in the same entity called human being. So wonderful. Supposing you get a chance to see within yourself what's happening to all the systems and all the devices and all the mechanisms that are creating life and your participation in life, and go in as deep as you can. It's a remarkable game going on. A remarkable game. It's called the world game. Great game. It's so beautiful. And you can tag yourselves on to any part of that game and get remarkable joy, satisfaction out of just watching it. You can be a great spectator. I tell you one little tip. If you want to enjoy life, become a spectator and become a listener. Sit behind the eyes. Consider that you have the windows of the body open. And look and see the drama of life going on around. Don't lose your seat as the spectator. And you get all the joy and life of this life. And if you want to be really wise and discover the truths that I have spoken of today or any other day, sit at the same place, not only as a spectator, but as a listener. Listen to what's happening. Don't speak. Don't think. Don't say. Just listen. You get all the truths. It's great to be a spectator and to be a listener in this drama.
As we progress along spiritual path, we see what the world condition is, and we see that some things like the past, we have another path to serve or to improve ourselves and then be able to serve as we improve. We see that, or from a psychology point of view, I see that the exact opposite, the antithesis to the individuation is an alienation, where the person who believes himself to be not part of anything anymore, but the other spectrum completely. And as you see someone who is that far removed from what they believe to be, they have no connection to anything whatsoever, by what path is the best to lead them back toward that level where they're almost at a level of not human consciousness or God consciousness. They've broken themselves off from the humanity, so to speak, and they believe themselves to be whatever. But is there a useful mechanism?
Yeah. The most useful mechanism to help people who are so removed from this unity, so removed from this oneness, that they feel isolated and cut off and have to be brought back into this mainstream. Most useful mechanism is to travel to their point and be in that point of view with them, then bring them back. If you talk to them from any other point of view, they can reject you, but that is why they are there. They went there to reject you. If you say, no, we know it, and come back, they say, we know what you know. It's your philosophy, speculation, your thought. You have to walk right up to where they are. Go down deep into the mess that they have created and be like them, befriend them, love them, and bring them up. Yeah. Even God had to do that. Even God, when He wants to save us, has to come right to our level, take us back. Okay, I hope you enjoyed the sharing just as much as I did. And some of you may be coming to the workshop tomorrow. We'll have more experiential work on the same subject. Thank you very much and good night. God bless you.